A tiny bit about me. I used to be an investment banker. That's why I still wear shirts like this. And most of my work now is focused on free businesses, mainly in the world of games. They're most of my clients at the moment. Last week, I spent a full day giving a masterclass in the Ministry of Sound, which was it's the only time I've ever been in the Ministry of Sound, which has its own kind of weirdness, with a slide deck like this on the main dance floor, which is kind of a bit weird. I also was in Universal Music Group, so I'm talking a lot around music. And I'm also applying this quite a lot to the book industry. I think it applies to all creative industries, and I think it will soon apply to all industries selling anything at all in the world. So, you know, no pressure on me. My clients, the first thing they say is, you can't make money from apps. They say, we've got to make people start valuing content again, and I deserve to be paid for my work. And what I say is, oh yes you can, oh no you can't, oh no you don't. They really don't like that last one when I say it. You need to earn the right to be paid. There is more content out there than we could possibly consume in our entire lives. And lots of it is really, really good. And lots of it is free legally, without having to go through BitTorrent and other dodgy places. You need to earn the right to be paid because, frankly, your competitors, and in your world of music, your competitors are people getting other people's attention. In the world of business, obviously, there's a slightly different definition. But your competitors are choosing to give really high quality stuff away for free. Because, in the words of Tim O'Reilly, obscurity is a bigger problem for me than piracy. I'm going to give this good stuff away for free. And if I then work out how to make more money from giving something away for free than you are earning for charging for that same thing, in the long run, you are essentially stuffed. And the idea that the industry can run to politicians and say, can you criminalise our customers? Which I think is a terrible idea. At precisely the moment we want our customers to love us, we're saying, by the way, you're criminals. And the politician says, well, the guys in yesterday said they don't want to criminalise the customers. They want to give them lots and lots of music or content or stuff for free. They want to give 50 million voters free stuff. And you want me to say, no, that's going to be bad. I think I'm on these guys' side, thank you very much. We can't win that battle. I think we can fight it for a while. I spent some time talking about the football industry. And we'll talk about that a tiny bit more. But I don't know, those of you who followed the music industry for a while and then see the Premier League saying, if our fans come to our football matches and there is a goal scored and they take a vine of it and post it onto social media, we will prosecute them. You kind of go, whoa, 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 whoa. These are people who love this thing so much, a moment that's so important to them, they'll spend 80 quid on a ticket and travel halfway across the country to do it, and they want to share this moment of high emotion with their friends, and you tell them that's illegal? You're just making the mistake the music industry made 10 years ago at trying to criminalise people for sharing the stuff they were most passionate about. Of course, what the Premier League is saying is, well, hold on a minute, we've sold the rights to really short clips to football stuff to newspapers, and we can't... If it's given away for free, how will we be able to sell that? And I think there's a realistic risk. The answer is you can't, unless you're prepared to alienate all of your fans. And I don't think that on balance in the long run, that's a good outcome. I also think the consequence is that a whole bunch of footballers get paid roughly half of what they currently get paid, and I'm fine with that outcome. So I'm not terribly worried about the football industry as a whole. I do think that's one to watch, though, because how they respond is going to be a really interesting piece of evidence as to how you work with fans. But before that, I want to do some stuff talking about free. I am often known as the free guy. I'm not actually a freetard. I don't believe everything has to be free. I do believe that everything has to have variable pricing, that you have to enable people who love what you do to spend lots more than a single standard price. I also think free is an amazing way of finding an audience, but it's a marketing technique, not a must-have or an answer. There's no point in giving something away for free unless you know what it's for. One of my issues with the Apple thing, which was mentioned earlier, is that giving half a billion people an album against their will doesn't entirely start... Sorry, it's a bit strong, but I didn't ask for it. My wife genuinely, because I knew it was coming, my wife went, what the hell's this on her album? And my iPhone is very full all of the time. I download a lot of games for work. I spend a lot of time trying to keep it empty. And just taking up space on my iPhone is an imposition that actually upsets me. So my starting point of my emotional relationship with YouTube, I mean, I obviously have history, but is not, this is lovely. It is, you have just made my life harder. I now have to go and delete a thing. And then if you try to delete it, you can't. I mean, it can't be done. You can delete the files from your phone, but you can't. It cannot be deleted from your library. It can never be taken away from your identity. If you construct your identity as being the music I own and the books I own and the clothes I wear as who I am now a U2 owner. And that, I can't undo it, it's literally not allowed. As we run through this exercise, you'll see why I'm so unhappy about that. But first of all, I want to talk about this. Does anybody know what this is? Put your hand up if you know what this is. Somebody shout it out. It's Candy Crush. Who's played it? Some of you are lying. Who's got beyond level 10? Level 30? Level 35? Is it really just you? No, other people are lying. Candy Crush is free. 300 million people have played it in the last month. That's 15% of all the people connected to the internet in the entire world. 93 million people played it yesterday. And the game is free and made $1.5 billion last year. So clearly free doesn't mean doesn't make any money. It's not just Candy Crush. These were the top grossing apps on the iPhone a few weeks ago. You can see that I've downloaded a bunch of them. Those are the free apps. So Apple measures success by how much money it makes. I mean, it's properly capitalist in that sense. It isn't most popular, it's top grossing, makes the most revenue. Those are the free ones. The only paid ones are Grindr, so casual sex for gay men. Casual sex for straight people, Tinder, that's free, but gay people will pay for it. I don't fully understand that model. And there's a free version. Grindr's free, so why is that one in the list? So obviously I don't understand the model.
You get free and then you upgrade.
But this one's 69p. Ah, okay.
You get it automatically. I mean, you get the paid 69p a week.
Yeah. 69p a week?
I've never upgraded.
69p a week?
I think it might be a month.
Interesting, interesting. So I should dig more into that. No, I shouldn't. Sorry, that came out wrong. So let's talk about TomTom instead, which is a place which sells maps. And I suspect one of the reasons it's up at the top of the charts is because the maps are so expensive. I suspect over time it's going to lose out to the free map offerings from Google and Apple. And I can see why they're keeping the price really, really high at the moment, but I don't think that's sustainable. But all of these games, Clash of Clans makes about $800 million. The company does out of three games, of which that's one, just sold for $3 billion. These guys are making lots and lots of money. Kim Kardashian's making at least $100 million a year. I think it's probably higher now that it's that far up the charts. So free makes money, and it's not just on the App Store. Again, in games, these are the most successful games of the last year, and I changed the format and it didn't come up on this one. Six of the top 10 most revenue-generating games in the world are free. So clearly you can make money from free. The games industry has proven it. I now need to dig a slight bit into how that works for music.
Even World of Warcraft, you get a month for free.
World of Warcraft, you absolutely do. So you get a month for free, and they started changing it until you get to a certain level, you don't have to pay. And they also have a variable pricing piece on the end where you can buy pets. Have you bought a pet in World of Warcraft?
No.
You can buy pets in World of Warcraft, which you can earn pets in the game, which make you travel across the space faster, horses and the likes. But if you want a dragon, it costs $25 because the dragons are cool. It does the same thing as the horse, it's just faster. No, it isn't. It's exactly the same speed. It's just cooler. And that's a really important thing to hold on to, that one of the things we're actually selling is not content. People expect that for free. We're selling how the content makes them feel, and not necessarily just directly. You have an advantage. You make music. Music naturally makes people feel. But how the ownership of the music or the connection with the music makes them feel. I think I've illustrated that my connection with YouTube is not entirely positive. That's because it makes me feel something. There's other albums which I'm very proud of owning. In my house, I'm probably a little bit more defined by books than music these days. I very carefully, downstairs, have a whole bunch of history books and politics books and history books. And when you get to know me a bit better, you come upstairs where you find my fantasy books and my sci-fi books and my crime lit and all of that kind of stuff. Because there's different aspects of my persona that I wish to display. And I will spend quite a lot of money on that in a bunch of different ways. Another way of thinking about it is that when you got up this morning, you thought, what am I doing today? Am I sitting around on my own when no one is looking? Or am I going to a conference where lots of people will see who I am? And the clothes you choose to put on, the hat you chose to wear, said something about who you are to yourself and to other people. And I'm increasingly of the view that content's role in life, because you can't sell it directly anymore, is to be part of that sense of identity of self-expression. It always was. But we kind of wrapped up what people paid for in the pressing of the disc and the distribution and the cost of the chap in HMV who sold it to me. And now that's all gone away and they can get it for free. If we want them to give us some money, all of these fans who love what we do, we have to say there is something that's emotionally important to you that involves you giving me money. Which is some of the stuff which... now forgotten the name of the chap from Lewis Silkin, the lawyer was saying, Cliff, thank you, what Cliff was saying when he was talking about his trousers. And he's absolutely right that the cost of goods are basically the same, but people will pay 100 times more for a different branded version. And music isn't as simple as just that brand, there's a lot more to it. And I'm going to run out of time if I keep digressing. So, the secret is that you have to flip your thinking. The web has done one thing we're all very familiar with. It's made it really, really easy to share your content or your ideas for free, and it's also made it really easy for people to share your content or ideas against your will for free. That's just happened, and we tend to obsess about that bit. But it's also enabled one-to-one communications with people in a way that was kind of impossible to understand before. In my world of games, if I walk into a shop and I'm looking at a Tomb Raider or something, the shop assistant doesn't know whether or not I am the world's biggest Tomb Raider fan who would pay an enormous amount to meet Lara Croft. She's not real, but there you go. But an enormous amount to pay that. I say that, I have met the Lara Croft, the second one. Not Angelina Jolie, but one of the models from Tomb Raider, but that was a long time ago. So there you go, that was at a trade show. So you can meet Lara Croft, or whether or not actually you'd have to pay me to play this game. This assistant couldn't tell. But the web gives you ways to start getting inside people's heads, to let them tell you how much they're prepared to pay. So, that's the curve. The curve says we line up every person in the world in a long line and we magically peer inside their heads and we go, how much do you value what I do? Those of you who are on the creative side of music, which is probably most of you, will be depressed to learn that nearly everybody in the world sits on this line. Nothing at all. Out of 7 billion people, the number of people who value my book, The Curve, is a rounding error. It's basically zero. But there are some people who value it at $1 or $10, and there are some people who value me or my time at $100 or $1,000 or even $10,000. And what I'm saying here is that the free end of the curve is a marketing opportunity. I've carefully not taken that straight down to zero. It's a marketing opportunity. That is where you give up, you either give stuff away to people who wouldn't pay something, or you accept that some people who would have paid you something get something for free as a way of widening your funnel in web technology parlance. Finding the audience. But, and this is the important bit, you then have to have a strategy which enables you to connect with and talk to the people who are further up here. And I think you also need a strategy to move people along that curve over time. So that's the revenue opportunity. So that's the curve. It's these three parts. You find an audience, almost certainly using free, but you don't have to. Earn the right to talk to them again and enable superfans. So I want to talk about the free people first. I called them freeloaders in the hardback. My publisher told me that people didn't like being called freeloaders and told me that I should call them followers, but I haven't yet because I prefer this phrase, but it may happen. Freeloaders are incredibly valuable. Freeloaders who never spend any money with you still give you a lot of important stuff. It used to be that we would say if they didn't give me money, they should basically bugger off because they're not my real fans, and I don't think that's right anymore. There's at least four different ways they're valuable. The first is a potential source of revenue. If you're really big, you can put ads around your stuff. You can certainly do that in games. A chap in the audience asked the question about how do I get a brand to do what I think Cliff called a sync deal and those kind of things. The more customers you have, the more people you have listening to your stuff, the more opportunity there is to monetize them in that way. That's not my area of focus. I'm very focused on how you make money directly from fans, how you, in the phrase I'm not allowed to use, take money from your fans, rather than how you build a big audience and sell them in a traditional way. I have nothing against this. I think it's very good. It's just not my area of expertise. The second thing is word of mouth. If you want people to discover your stuff, you need lots of people to be listening to it. They need to be able to tell their friends. Increasingly, through technology, you need to be able to see that somebody's listening to something on Spotify or they liked it on Facebook. In my world of the App Store, where discovery is so heavily driven by the charts, the further up the charts you go, the more people discover you, the further up the charts you go. As a result, I mean, Clash of Clans, which was at the top of the top grossing, is spending between $500,000 and $1 million a day on marketing to stay near the top of the charts. It's making so much money that that's worth it, and the nearer the top of the charts it is, the more free downloads it gets over time, so it becomes a virtuous circle. So the word of mouth, this is the world, by the way, where we are paying people to play our games. Well, we're actually not. It's in a world of sort of slave trading because we're buying people to play our games from other people's games. That's what we're doing. We're trading customers around because we find the right place where they love it enough to spend money. I say it like that, it sounds a bit exploitative, doesn't it? The next thing that's really important is potential converts. It used to be that somebody would walk into HMV and either buy the album or not. it wasn't the case that they would listen to it a dozen times and then buy it, because that model didn't exist. In my world of games, where I have a lot more data, it's very common. Well, there's two different views. Amazon says anybody who's going to go on to become a super fan, i.e. spend more than $100 in your game, 55% of them will spend on day one. Papaya, which is a Chinese company which tracks a lot of different Western games, says actually somebody who goes on to be a super fan, same definition, won't spend any money at all for the first 10 times they interact with your app. So two completely opposing pieces of data there. For my mind, as long as somebody isn't costing you anything or costing you very little, you should go, you know what, you're loving my music. I'm happy. That's a good start. I have the potential to move you on to spend money, but as long as you're not, it's actually great that you're telling other people, you're filling your Spotify playlist, and maybe I get a tiny bit of money from the Spotify stream for that stuff happening. But the most important category is gawkers, and it's kind of misunderstood. Essentially, for somebody to be a fan of something, they have to be normal people who aren't fans. And for them to be a super fan, they have to be normal people and fans and super fans. You need the distinction between the two to make a difference. I'm more of a fan than you are, I think you'll find. I haven't said that since I was a teenager. But that kind of stuff is really, really important. I'm sure that Ferrari could make its cars quieter and less red. But it needs people's heads to turn when it goes past. That's one of the things it's selling, as well as engineering and Italian style and all of that stuff. The same stuff about our clothes. We choose to spend money to stand out from other people. Where I think there's a great example when Trent Reznor, who's often pulled out by both sides of this debate, because he left his label and he went back to his label and everything else. But is anybody familiar with the release of his album Ghosts? Does anybody remember that? He left the label system. He obviously was built by the label system, so he had a lot of fans through traditional measures, which was one of the things which Rob was saying today, was that the label system still has a place. He left the label system. He released an album called Ghost 1-4. It was 4 9-track albums released as kind of one package. And he uploaded the first Ghost 1 to BitTorrent and said, come and get it, it's there, as a distribution channel. He obviously knew it would take about 10 minutes before the other stuff appeared there in the same kind of place. From his website, you could pay him $5 to download the album. That was an honesty box. You could get it for free if you wanted to, but here's an easy legal way for you to give me money if you choose to. For $10, you'd get the album. For $75, you'd get the deluxe edition. And for $300, you'd get the ultra deluxe edition. It was 4 CDs, 3 books. How many CDs did you have in yours? I'm just looking. It was like this. Which was your one, but it was $300. And this, how much was this that somebody paid for this one? $50. So cheap. Should have charged more.
Well,
on Kickstarter, it was $25. Sorry, Mishkin, wasn't it? Ran a Kickstarter to fund that album. So I'm really, really. You should talk to her about her experiences later. The $300 Trent Reznor version was a calfskin sleeve, 3 books, 4 CDs. Numbered, there are only 2,500 of them, signed by Trent, touched by Trent, if you're that type of fan. And he had $300, 2,500. He sold out of them all in the first day, the first 30 hours, actually. So he made $750,000 from a $300 product. He made $1.6 million in the first week. When he had uploaded his stuff to BitTorrent and gave his entire album away for free, he did everything in between. And the thing is that the free strategy was part of that, because he wanted somebody to walk into his house, or somebody to walk into the house of somebody who spent $300 and go, oh, you've got one of those, have you? You must be a big fan. You must be rich. You must be any number of different things. You must be a great connoisseur, or what on earth did you do? Each of those are different emotional reactions which might have occurred. But it mattered that lots of people knew about it in order for the top thing to be special. Does anybody remember the iPhone app I Am Rich? Does anybody remember it? It's $1,000 for a picture of a diamond. That's what it was. And it was, Apple withdrew it after a while. In fact, they brought in a new rule that you can't sell something for more than $99 in a single purchase in a game. There's plenty of games which make more than that from a single customer. But it was just status. Look at me, I'm rich. Now that's only one way of doing it. I prefer I'm educated, I have great taste, I'm lovely to my friends, or whatever it might be. There's many different facets of our character which you might choose to display. The ones which are easiest and most surprising are things like that. I mean, just naked bling in all its glory. But those same kind of feelings of self-expression at its latest is the thing which we should be trying to sell. I'm running a little bit behind. So now I'm going to talk about this piece, the tech piece. You don't need to be technical to do this stuff. You do need to understand what your audience values. That can mean digging deep into analytics and tracking everything they do, or it can mean running a Kickstarter where you put a whole bunch of different reward tiers up and see what it is they value, or do something on PledgeBank. I self-published a book called The Free-to-Play Toolbooks. It's a very business-to-business book, which I published in February this year. In August 2011, I put a banner ad up on my website. The book then was called 52 Game Design Secrets, which was a rubbish name. And when people clicked on the banner, it took them to a page where it said, "Thank you for clicking on the banner. This book doesn't exist yet, but the fact that you clicked on the banner tells me that there is interest in it, and when I get enough of you, I'll go away and write it. Do you want to give me your email address, and I will send you an email when it happened?" It took me 3 years to write it. I did feel that I couldn't do anything similar until I'd either said I'm not going to or finished on the job. But it demonstrated to me that there was a market for a product which I eventually shipped. And then you need to earn the right to talk to them again. And this is where I think a lot of people go wrong. It's all well and good to be where the audience are. In fact, it's critical to be where the audience are. But your job is to move people from where the audience are to a place where you can choose when to talk to them again, not rely on the massive spotlight of Amazon's recommendation system or Genius or something to bring you back to people's attention. So let's talk social networks first of all. I'm too old to understand Tumblr. I'm too male to understand Pinterest. I'm too married to understand Snapchat. But your audience might be in all of these different places. Your job is to figure out where your audience is, get them to give you permission to communicate with them. I'm a little bit nervous about Facebook. I think what with Facebook at the moment, you're earning the right to pay Facebook to talk to them again. And I think that Twitter is going the same way. It made a small change in its rules earlier this year, which said if you are a brand, I think that means, you know, a musician wouldn't be a brand, but I only think that. If you are a brand, it is no longer the case that when you tweet, it will necessarily appear in the feed of your followers. And that means that they're going to charge to make that happen. So next year, you will be paying to, you'll have earned the right to pay Twitter to talk to your fans. And that will happen across every social network again and again. So you always need to be rolling your fans forward onto a place where you don't have to pay with them. I love email. Partly it's because I'm old and used to be a banker. But mainly it's because it's a platform that once you give them an email address, I own it. I can now send stuff. Somebody, Gavin was talking about sending an old-fashioned postcard. Now that was back in the days before email was an option. But people's physical address, now that's awesome. And customers' physical addresses, people who have bought stuff from me. Now, that's really awesome. In fact, I've just thought I'm not doing enough with that. But there we go. So you need to earn the right to talk to them again, and that's a really important part of this. As I keep saying, I have a book called The Curve. You can download, you can buy that from Amazon. You can also download a free version called 10 Ways to Make Money in a Free World, which is part of my free curve. And what I'm doing there is I'm going, you know what? There's a whole bunch of people who will read my book. They'll buy it from Amazon or Waterstones via Penguin's publishing process. And they're never going to become my superfans. They're never going to be on that journey. And that's okay. That's paid for marketing. What I mean by that is I get paid for the marketing that I'm getting from this, which is amazing. But my job is to take the 10 or 20% of people from who have read my book, who have the potential to move further along the curve. Over my lifetime as well. I'm not just talking about for the product, which is one of the problems that Penguin has with getting their heads around this. Because I'm not interested in the Curves curve. I'm interested in the Nicholas Lovell curve. But whisper that quietly, don't tell Penguin that. So I'm trying to move people along that curve. My job is to see Sainsbury's and Waterstones and Amazon and Penguin as a distribution channel for my ideas. And my job is to get them out of that distribution channel which other people own into one that I own. And I won't take all of them, because a whole bunch of them will take the curve and then pick up, you know, the next Malcolm Gladwell, he says arrogantly, hoping he's in that category, and the next big business idea book, and just move on, and that's fine. He's on a different curve. She's on a world of I'm on a curve of business book loving rather than Nicholas Lovell loving. And that's fine. It's just a different place. I'm just not in that place. So my job is to move them. I did it really badly. The hardback version of The Curve, at the end, it had a deeply needy, please come to my website, and that was kind of it. And I went, no, when I read it again, I went, nobody likes a needy plea. That's ridiculous. So the paperback version, I wrote a bunch of case studies. I got to the end and I said, right, there's the book. That's what was in the hardback. Now we've got examples of how Nespresso does it. Nespresso, the coffee machine, is a brilliant example of the curve. How comic books do it, how system integrators do it. That's only for the really geeky. And we wrote a whole bunch of these things. And I said at the end of that, if you come to my website and sign up, you will get these new case studies as soon as I write them. So here's great free content you will get forever, and all you have to do is give me an email address. That's what you're paying. And that has worked much better than the original, oh please. And I think that's an important lesson in its own right. Having earned the right to talk to them again, you need to figure out how to get them to give you money. And that means you have to let those who love what you do spend lots of money on things they truly value. And all three bits really matter. I keep coming back to this word. It's really hard. They don't have to give you any money. There's so many things they can do as an alternative. You have to make them love you in order to get them to reach into their pockets. You also need those people who do love you to spend lots of money. It used to be the case, if you were selling albums, that 100% of people paid $10. Now, £10. Now, let's do a very simple false mass calculation. Let's imagine that only 10% of people give you any money at all. To make the same amount of revenue, you're going to leave aside gross margin, but to make the same amount of revenue, you need those people to spend $100, £100, rather than 10. And if you want an average of £100, then you probably need somebody spending £1,000 in order to get that 100. Otherwise, you can't get there because of all the people down below. And they need to truly value it. There was anybody upstairs when I admitted I owned a Hearsay album. So this is the moment to say, I don't own the second one. That bit they didn't get past. They didn't get the past, did I truly value it? Once you can fool me into buying a piece of something. If I didn't really like it, if I didn't really love it, I'm not coming back. And I think that's one of the things that was coming up from the Lady Laura about saying taking money from your fans, and she objected to the phrase taking. And I think she's right, because if your view is that I'm going to take money from my fans, you can't keep that. You might be able to do that for a while, but then that means your job is to keep finding new people to put through the treadmill of disillusionment. And I think that's a very, very hard process to do. And I don't think it fits most of what you guys want to do. So that matters. How do we do that? Let's talk about games. Anybody know who this is? Not the Cookie Monster, the other one. He's a guy called Tim Schafer, and he makes video games that nobody likes, or publishers kept telling him that. He made really popular games through the 90s, point-and-click adventures like The Tale of Monkey Island and a game called Psychonaut. They were quite thoughtful, they were funny, they were comical. And then we invented consoles and shooting people in the head. And it turned out to be much easier and cheaper to make games that involve shooting people in the head in more and more colourful ways. And his games were harder to make. And publishers went, there isn't a market for what you do. And he said, no, there is. I know there is. They used to buy it. They haven't gone away. I just can't reach them. Wouldn't it be great if I had a way to talk to them and say, will you give me money to make the stuff that you used to like, that I think you still do like? So he announced, again, I will admit that he came through the old label system. He said, you know what, I'm going to run a Kickstarter. And I'm just going to say, I'm going to make games like I used to. For $15, you'll get the digital version of my album. That's what your £15 thing should have been, the digital version. For $30, you get an album and a making of. For $100, you get a special edition box with the disc of the game and the DVD of the documentary, a T-shirt, a poster. I love this bit. Suitable for framing. He's kind of doing that display thing. He's telling you that this is about displaying that you backed this campaign. For $1,000, you get a picture of you drawn by one of the artists in the game, very personal and bespoke. For $5,000, you get a large original piece of artwork. And for $10,000, you get lunch with me, he sold. Does anybody back this? You're not my normal crowd. I normally get about 10% of the crowd saying yes. So I backed it. 87,000 other people backed it. He went out to raise $400,000. He got that on day one, and in the 30 days, he made that much money. Those of you who are good at maths will see immediately that he made $38.28 per unit or per customer, which is about the price of a game. And it's the same kind of average price as a PC game. I used to be a banker, so I like numbers. And the thing about Kickstarter, the reason you should look at it, is that all of these numbers are out there. These are creative people running experiments where you get all the data. And they said $15. Nearly 50,000 people. That's pretty well everybody. So, yeah, it's more than half of people, sorry, back to that tier. Another big chunk at the $30 tier, that's where I was. A big spike at $100 because it's good value, but the rest kind of don't matter. And I looked at them and went, that doesn't make sense to me. This makes sense to me. I looked at it by revenue. And I went, you know what, from the revenue, the top, the $100 tier was a third of the money raised. The $20 tier isn't terribly important. If it really focused on just this lot, if he hadn't been able to do this, he would have made a tiny fraction of the amount of money that he eventually went on to make. I did a final analysis. The people who spent $1,000 or more, 0.1% of the pledge is 6% of the money. 250, 1% of the pledge is 15% of the money. But this is the key one. 15% of the audience were 50% of the money, and those were the people who spent more than $100. And that figure of $100 comes up again and again, as I said upstairs. Indiegogo says a third of all pledges are at exact, a third of all revenue raised is from $100 exactly. Exactly that figure. 75% of all revenue raised is from $50 plus. And I suspect most of you who've run Kickstarters have not put enough thought into the high-end tiers. You've not allowed the people who really want to let you do cool stuff give you money to do it. You've basically been a bit scared, maybe worried about being needy, I don't know. Or maybe just haven't spent enough time experimenting. Some stuff won't sell. I've been given a 5-minute warning, so I'm going to go super fast. I want to talk first of all about something which is totally non-digital. This is the least digital product I can think of, flour. You can't distribute it on YouTube, it can't be BitTorrented. But the company behind it, King Arthur, has become the second largest miller from the fifth in the US, turnover of $100 million a year, with a curve strategy. At the bottom end, it has videos on YouTube. Its most popular one is how to measure a cup of flour. Does anybody bake in the room? Anybody bake? More people bake than play games, or maybe more people admit to baking than playing games. The American cup system is ridiculous and doesn't work. If you scoop a cup of flour out like that, the weight of the flour compacts it down. You get 20% more flour than if you spoon it in like that, the proper way of doing it. You didn't expect to learn baking tips today. If you get 20% more flour than you intended, that will ruin your choux pastry. They have a website full of tips, as you'd expect. They have a phone line where friendly middle-aged ladies answer the phone and reassure you about how well you're doing, or tell you to go back and start again because you didn't measure the flour properly. They sell flour in shops, like I sell books in Sainsbury's. They sell recipe books and rolling pins, and I'm deeply disturbed to see that rolling pins are worth a lot more than books now that I'm a published author. But they also sell superfan events. You can fly to their Vermont headquarters and spend $500 to learn how to make choux pastry, which basically means how do you, you know, they basically teach you this for $500. They don't. You become part of a community, you're there, and when you go back to the towns and villages and suburbs of North America, people turn to you and go, you're that baking person, aren't you? You're somebody who knows about this stuff. How do I become a better baker? And you start them here, and they go through the same cycle again. So it doesn't always work. Very short of time, but Bjork ran a crowdfunding campaign. She has 2.5 million Twitter followers, 4.5 million Facebook likes. She tried to raise £350,000 for her biophilia Android app, and she raised 15,000 quid before they cancelled it. And there were a bunch of things wrong with it. It was already out on iPhones. There was no joy of creation. The rich people, the iPhone users, sorry to the Android users, had already got the stuff. So it was, I can't be asked to pay for it for the cheap people, so you'll have to do it yourself, which was bad marketing. The tech in the room went, 350,000 for a port, you're kidding me. But most dangerously, her Twitter stream was, Bjork will be performing in Helsinki tonight. Bjork will be playing in Berlin tonight, buy tickets. Bjork will be performing in Dresden tonight. That was all it was. And when she tried to activate 2.5 million followers, they said, no. We're not your fans. We are people who followed you on Twitter once. I did try and get a picture of the tweet stream. The tweet stream is better now, but it deeply looks as if they fired the rubbish marketing intern and replaced her with a good marketing intern, or him, with a good marketing intern. Not that Bjork is now engaging with the fans directly. So just having followers isn't enough. So, the curve for music, because I'm right at the end. You have to decide what you're going to give away for free. You have to earn the right to talk to them again. Something else I don't think you two did in their giveaway. And you've got to figure out what you're going to sell for 10 times, 100 times, or 1,000 times the previous average price. My summary is that you have to love your freeloaders. They are the people who are on the start of this journey towards becoming your superfans, and they provide context for the superfans. You have to love your superfans because they're going to give you the money. And you have to love everyone in between because they're on a journey and you never know who's going to make it to the very top of this curve. So, love your freeloaders, love your superfans, love everyone in between. I'm Nicholas Lovell. I love you all. Thank you very much. I realise I've overrun. I'm very happy to take questions, but if people need to leave for the next event, I won't be offended. Yes? Yes?
When I went to work yesterday, my boss said they would just call Apple to complain that someone hacked his account and bought a new
smartphone. That's brilliant. That's brilliant. I don't want to admit that it's true. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Now or beforehand? The heart of it is they went for the old traditional model, which goes, I control, you respond, it's in my world. I would have tried to create a structure which made it a deeply aspirational thing to get the new YouTube stuff. I've seen pretty well no social media saying, yay, I've got the new album. And lots of it going, boo, I've got the new album. And some of that is less around the album itself and more about that loss of control and that sense of I construct my self-identity and you've broken that and everything else. I can see why Apple did it. They're a very command and control company. I can see why YouTube did it. They're a very broadcast era rock band. But I think that it totally fails to see the transition relationship. The first thing I'd have done as I was YouTube is go, I'm not that interested in getting it there. Can you give me the email addresses of all the people who listen to it? Because that would have been almost more valuable to me than the money in that sense. Apple would have said no, quite rightly, but I'd have been trying to figure out how to do that. And the second thing I'd be doing is trying to go, how can I work out, once somebody has listened to this, how I transition them into a place where I can talk to them again? That exact place, I don't know. They actually have quite a big fan club. And the fan club, basically, I think you pay something like 50 quid a year and you get early access to gig tickets. That's what you pay. So you just, I mean, it's like Amazon Prime. You're paying to be a customer, which is a slightly odd kind of structure. So it may be that, you know what, they've already got that back end of their conversion funnel working, and they took a gamble which said our problem is that we're becoming deeply uncool, not enough new people are finding us, we're basically just continually churning out, taking money from dad rockers, and we need to try an opportunity to change that. And this is the way of doing it. I do think it's slightly heavy-handed, though. I don't think it feels respectful of your fan relationship. It feels damaging. I mean, I overplayed the U2 stuff, although I have actively spent my life trying not to own a U2 album, and it does feel a bit weird that now I do own one. The email is completely dying out, and you are quite right. The problem is that it's about the only earning the right format that I'm confident I own. So email and physical addresses are two things where I have the ability to communicate with people entirely on my terms. All the other stuff is dependent on the platform not pulling the rug out from underneath me. So although I would never say you should only have email, the Facebook likes, I think, is the great example, is that Facebook likes about 4 years ago were worth way more than a Facebook like is now in terms of what we can do with it. I think Twitter's going the same way. That's fine, you should keep refreshing your social networks and moving to where your customers are, and right now, maybe it's in WhatsApp, maybe it's in Pinterest, maybe it's in Snapchat, maybe it's in Instagram. We've seen some people do great work with Instagram and so on. But that is quite tiring to keep up with all of those things. It's fine if that's your life, you know, find one which you love. I have a bit of a problem, which is that there are certain formats I love. I love blogging, I love Twitter, I like Facebook. I don't like YouTube as a format, as a social format. Video isn't my thing. That's a big problem for the work I do. It just isn't me. And that's a problem because that's important to me. But I should be much more active on YouTube in terms of that community. So I don't know the right answer. I keep going on about email. One, without knowing anything about you, you may or may not be in an office job. If you're still in an office job, email is more important. It's still real if you're in the office job because it just... You just have to use it. You don't have any choice. So some of it is that there might be a lot of people who aspire to be like you and don't have an office job. I'm making assumptions here. You might do. And actually, if you're in an office job, you still have email. Your broad point, however, that email is dying is totally valid. It's just still the one we control the best. And that's why I end up there.